Little Ham says it's time to rock and roll.
Bring the noise.
Good evening, folks, and welcome to the Etims podcast. My name is Desi Mond, and I'm very glad to say that I am joined by a full house tonight. On the top right of my screen, I have Monty C. Burns. Good evening, Monty.
Evening, Desi. Evening, lads.
Thank you very much for joining. And on the bottom right, we have Ralph Malve. Ralph, are you indoors at this point? Sometimes you like to join us from the outdoors down in Stoke.
I'm sitting by the window and just relaxing after a long, tough day.
Well done, nice. And in the bottom left-hand corner, we've got Hector Bandido, our resident tactician, and board aficionado, which is something we'll come to later.
Friend
on.
Of the board. Friend, yes, of the board.
Good, a very good friend of the board. We'll come
evening,
to that
everyone.
Later on, obviously.
If I should be talking to you, riffraff, actually.
Thank you very much, gentlemen, for joining us. Hector is our witness that we have tried to get a female companion onto the podcast. But lo and behold, we were knocked back. We did try and get some female interest in the podcast, so that was a shame. So hopefully in the future, we will try and get a female perspective and a younger perspective onto the podcast sector, because we do appreciate we are the Celtic da-stroke grandas of the podcasting world these days. But we'll see what happens as we move on.
Who's the granda?
I'm
my boy. I'm not the granda.
I have three grand.
So you're the youngest one of us, and you've got three grandways, and the rest
go
of us are hee
haw. It's an Irish thing.
Go then.
Jerry Adams was right. Let's be honest.
Breed them out.
Shipping them all off the lawn crash.
That's it. You've got to get those polling numbers up somehow. Right. So that's where we are today, folks. So. The last time we chatted, we were looking forward to a big run of games, and surprisingly, it wasn't half a big run of games. So, Hector, just let me just take you through. Since our last chat, we had a 6-1 win against Hibs, we had a 4-0 away win at Motherwell, we had a 4-3 win against Hearts, we drew 1-1 with Shakhtar, and we also had a 3-0 away win against Livy. I'll come to the VAR Madrid and the Dundee United games in turn. But those five games, quite a run, quite considering quite a lot of goals and quite a few impressive away games.
They've done really well, certainly domestically. Just for you guys, come on, very briefly talking to Desi about that. And I think what it has done, it's reinforced the importance of Angie's squad rotation. Remember, there's two games earlier in the season. One was away to Ross County in the League Cup midweek, and I think he made like 10 changes for that game. And we won, was it 3-1 or 4-1? In the League Cup, and he did a similar change. It wasn't as many as 10, maybe 7 players against St Mirren away. He beat us deservedly so 2-0. And at that point, this squad rotation doesn't work. But since then, he's just continued that. And what's been interesting is, one, the results, two, keeping the players fresh, and three, every player contributing. And when I say contributing, look at the goals that's been scored. You get across all the way across the front line. You've got Giacomakis, you've got Kyogo, you've got Maeda, Abada, Forrest, Hax Ivanovic, every single one of them is contributing. And I think it just reinforces that Ange, domestically, has got everything spot on so far.
Yeah, but and Monty, Hector's alluding to the front line. Let's not forget the contributions from the back line. Super striker Greg Taylor suddenly discovered.
It's an interesting sort of path that we've took with this rotation. Because we're not used to it, obviously, but now we're seeing the benefits of it. You've always got that bit of trepidation. You're not quite sure, is this going to work, is it not? Then you probably amplify the mistakes. But when you look at how Taylor, Ralston, Bernabeu to a lesser extent, but certainly Juranovic, you look at the interchange of the fullback line, and there really isn't any impact. Bernabeu's maybe got a little bit to go in terms of polish, you know, he's raw, but no impact. You look at the fact we have had a solid, settled midfield three but we're giving everybody a half-hour break, or rotating the half-hour break, and among that, since McGregor got injured. I think throughout the team, it's that utopian sort of vision that we're kind of seeing maybe come to life, that we can swap players out and it doesn't impact the team. And that's a complete testament to not only the guy's eye for signing, but the mentality. And I picked up on a little quote from Tony Ralston after the match at the weekend. He talked about the fact there's no egos in there. He says, you look at the people who came on, nobody's sulking. Kyogo came on and scored what was, you know, potentially the winner in injury time. You know, no gruff, just get on with it. And they've all bought in. It's a weird and wonderful place we're in at the minute. Desi, long may it continue.
Yeah. So Ralph, do you think Callum McGregor can actually force his way back into this team come 2023, or is his days finished? Has Aaron Moy claimed that spot?
I think Miss McGregor, no matter what anybody says, and certainly missed in the crucial European games, but in a sense, ability-wise, we've not missed him. Leadership-wise, experience-wise, definitely. So, yeah, he'll be back. But it's nice to know that we've not dropped points domestically or dropped our style simply because what effectively is the main man's been out.
That's another positive, though, right? And obviously, at the time he was out, going to be out until at least the return after the World Cup. And Carter Vickers has been out quite a few games with injury, and Jota's been out quite. So we're actually without, I think, we're three best outfield players.
Yeah.
We've kept this consistency, this run of results, really high. All sorts of challenges going behind. You know, referee decisions will probably come there going against us. But without our three best players for large parts of those games, and to come out of it having extended our lead at the top to 7 points, I think that's a great sign.
Yeah, it's a very good point, but also a good point you made there, Ralph, just mentioning the word leadership. And it's the fact that players like O'Reilly have not, A, nor needed to rely on a Callum McGregor, i.e. an exclusive, an easy and available out ball, and actually, B, having to take up the challenge of being the leader on the pitch. Like, even, I know we're skipping ahead, but even watching like O'Reilly crossing the ball in for Kyogo's goal, even though that kind of idea, like stepping up in the last couple of minutes, no feeling defeatist, still having the actual gumption and the ability and the character, starting to show the character with, rather than relying on one guy like a McGregor, used to be like a Brown, having to be the actual personality in the team. It's actually quite good to see that coming through in a lot of them, I think. Quite interesting. I can't, to be real honest, I can't really remember much about the actual games. It's always nice to beat Hearts, especially in a 4-3 at Tynecastle, so to speak. Was that home? Was that away? The 4-3?
It was away, wasn't it?
It was notable purely for the excellence of the referee on display.
it was the first VAR game for us.
First VAR game.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, it's funny how we always seem to be these people that manage to get the joys of. And again, I think Ralph, hopefully everyone listening. Again, thanks, obviously everyone listening. Hope everyone listening is managing to catch Ralph's Etims diary at etims.net daily diary. Ralph, you have been I wouldn't say highlighting, but just reporting on the VAR situation is on each game as we go through, and the consistent inconsistency, let's say, of Scottish VAR. Do we actually believe the referees know the rule book? I listen to that Super Scoreboard, and every night Gordon Duncan tries to explain what the rule is. You know what I mean? And it never corresponds to what's happened in the game. So I actually wonder, does the ref know what the handball rule is?
Well, see the one at Tynecastle, the very first VAR game for us, Hearts had two penalties that in real time looked like penalties.
Yeah.
And I think the frustration was it took the VAR official, who was McLean, wasn't it, about 4 or 5 minutes to look at it time after time before calling over the referee, Nick Walsh, wasn't it? And he goes away and you're going, but that's a penalty. It doesn't take you 5 minutes to see that or the second one. Give a penalty. And then we come to the Forest one. I mean, Even what was interesting, it goes viral. So you get people down south of no allegiance to us looking at it going, referees down south going, what was the debate here? That's just a stonewall penalty kick. He's put his arm out to extend his body with the goes right. It was as stonewall a penalty as you could get. So there was actually no debate. It was three penalties. And yet here we go, farcical again by the match officials, sadly, on and off the field.
Yeah, and then that was kind of backed up when you meet some of the media pundits. I'm not saying they were doing it deliberately, but they were like, ultimately, it was like, that's not a penalty. Then it was the sitting on the fence. And we've even seen it this weekend with the whole Giakoumakis and the Bernabeu, which will come to. But again, it's that sort of way, like, these things are obvious. And Ralph, again, sorry to come back to you, but in your diary, you've been alluding to, this is the first time we've really started to see Ange being annoyed, even though he's obviously been annoyed in his time here. But he's managed to hide it very well, and he always used to always say, I don't get involved with refs, post-mortems are no use, etc. But it's clearly it's starting to annoy him, especially as Hector alludes to there, the time it's taken.
You could argue that if we were paranoid, and maybe we've got a good reason to be, that the whole system's come in to break up our style of play. Mm-hmm. We like to play quickly, we like to get on with the game, and these decisions, like Hector's just said, they're taking far too long. You look at the screen, yeah, that's a penalty, and that should be it. You don't need everybody else in the room to concur. That's if you're going to use that system.
Sorry, to jump in again, but just... It was interesting because the other one was Saturday's game, right? Dundee United. And the reason I wanted to come in there was your point there, Ralph, about breaking up the game. So, obviously, I was at the game. The corner comes in and the header what's his chop, Stephen Fletcher. Now, at the match, in real time, the header, and that was it, play on. There was no complaints. Dundee United had quite a reasonable away support. There was no complaints, shouting for them. There was nothing. Just play on. And it came as a total shock to everyone when it came up, penalty check. And we all thought, what's that for? Because nobody had a clue. But yet again, it took about 4 or 5 minutes to do that review. And for me, your point, Ralph, absolutely stands. It's breaking up the flow of the game. But number two, if it's taking a VAR official more than, say, 30 seconds to a minute, to me then you go with the call that's been given. There can't be enough evidence to change it. If there's no evidence to change it, you should know. It just take you 4 minutes, does it? Or 5 minutes.
But that's the paranoia thing. Is that them actually looking for a reason to award a penalty? And then you get the question, if so, why? Is it because they're afraid of scrutiny afterwards, afraid of getting it wrong, afraid of media attention after? These are only part-time guys.
But it killed the flow of the game, sorry, Desi. It killed the flow of the game for us. And I hadn't really thought about that till you said that. It was noticeable after that penalty. We sort of just, it sort of knocked us a bit because we'd stopped playing football for 5 minutes.
I read somewhere, Hector, that there was a school of thought that said that the refs and Scottish football are trying to figure out the way to use VAR correctly because there's no hard and fast way of doing it. It's meant to be for what they call a clear and obvious error. But in its early stages, and someone was suggesting that, I can't mind who it was, but they were suggesting that this was quite deliberate. What they were basically saying was, the ref will just get on with it, and VAR, because they're learning how to use the system, will then have a look at maybe a potential incident that the ref has clearly not seen, as opposed to strictly applying it to your point and saying, right, that's a stonewaller, the refs give it, have one quick look at that penalty, done. Don't look for reasons not to give it. So if this is deliberate, it would help explain it, and to Ralph's point on paranoia, you can't be paranoid enough for this, Char. But it would help explain the really, really daft delays in what are straightforward decisions. But nothing's ever explainable when it comes to the SFA because you are dealing with an amateur body. So fuck knows what's going on in that room. I believe it's back somewhere else. It's not even at the ground in which the game has taken place. It's a video feed back in somewhere else.
Is it not like Clydebank? Business Park or something, it's Caledonia House, it is,
and something mad or random. So it's not a real time, fully blown solution. I would say they're still, Hector, they're still in some sort of proof of concept, figuring it out mode. But
VAR Lite is the definition. Remember, that, we had an insider. VAR Lite is the official term.
Do you think that's why they've done it?
They've got a Betamax video camera at the game and a guy's pressing rewind and pause.
Be it. Do you think that's why they've done it just 3 weeks before the World Cup? They get two or three weeks in,
play,
and then get a break for a month.
Aye.
But again, there's a few, I started saying two things there. Now I'm up to five things, basically. But first, this made me think of something. One of the weirdest things is the two most experienced VAR officials in Scotland were Wally Collum and Bobby Madden. Just before VAR comes in here, Bobby Madden fucks off down to England.
In England,
that was very strange because he basically had a job set up for life there. He'd a VAR supervisor, expert, and again, you could have, even if he had to retire from refereeing, he could have become the VAR pundit. You know what I mean? On the, because like all the like Sky Sports and that, they love to have a refereeing pundit. I'm sure he'd had a nice wee job there. Now I'm trying to make, I don't know if anybody else read, but there was this you mentioned there, Hector, now for the breakup of the game. I've actually seen it now being reported that Celtic in their games make a lot of fouls. You know that way? It's actually one of these stats
which
isn't actually true. Like, we seem to have an invariable amount of fouls compared to the amount of time we have the ball. We have the ball for 79% of a game. But we have 79% of the fouls.
It's a complete, and we know Hector loves stats. It's a complete statistical outlier.
Yeah.
But this is explainable. It's explainable by the pace in which we try to claim the ball back. So if you take the
stats, that starts to tie in, right? So then, I could be having many false memories. I'm at that age now. It's my birthday last weekend. I'm at that age. But does anybody, I don't know if VAR, the rules have changed, but I'm sure at some point when it was in the English Premiership, there was like a kind of time barrier or something after an incident. Because I remember watching a game and it was like somebody kicked the ball out of play intentionally.
Yeah.
Because then that meant the ref had to go and pick up Eric. Because if the ball was in play for a certain period, it just plays on. I mean, like, you move on and you move into the next phase of play.
And that's,
you know, thinking, well, how did that not happen? And then the weirdest thing I heard post that weekend's game, the Giacomakis tackle, like basically a shoulder high, neck high tackle, about near enough in the face. And what I thought was even worse was the Kyogo tackle in that very last 30 seconds. That almost took his thigh off. And apparently VAR cannot get involved in what's deemed yellow card instance. They can't turn into the ref and go, that's a really bad challenge. Maybe you better look at that again. It's only if it's a possible red card.
But
it just seems like they're cutting their own throat. It's just madness.
That's it. Sorry, Ralph, you were going to say something because I have a point just to add to that. Sorry, I don't want to jump in front of you.
I can't remember what it was now.
that was two slops of Carling ago.
The thing about the inconsistency of the application of VAR, the whole fucking thing's a shambles, really. You have VAR and you have VAR Lite. I didn't know VAR Lite existed until Scotland implemented VAR Lite. You have no consistent set of rules that align VAR to the actual rule set of football that's applied globally. So you have nothing to fucking measure VAR's effectiveness by, because what they do in England is different to what they do in Scotland, is different to how they apply it in Spain, etc., etc. Sorry, Hector, come in.
No, just that Desi's point about the Giacomakis, the high foot challenge, right? Again, in the stadium, everybody jumped up screaming for a free kick. The ref didn't give a free kick for that. And then the ball goes out of play a few seconds later and it comes up on the screen, possible red card check. Now think about that. The ref, the whole stadium can see it. The ref didn't give a free kick for a foot almost at head tight. It might have been even at head tight, right?
Yeah,
it then goes to a possible red card. It's then checked for about 2 or 3 minutes and then they wave play on. So there's no foul given, no yellow card given for a possible red card offence, play on. See, how farcical is that?
But there's a point I just wanted to round out, because I enjoy watching American football and I also enjoy watching rugby for my fucking sins. In rugby, the TMO check is a brilliant thing to miss things, for things that the ref misses. In American football, the fact that there's about 65 of them all refereeing one ref and a whole load of touch judges with flags and everything else is a brilliant way to better referee the game. VAR is none of those two things, but it's trying to pick a bit of this and a bit of that. And that's why I think its implementation in Scotland is completely flawed. If it's there to check on errors that the ref makes, you can't specify what errors it checks by something so subjective as what is a red card offence. So a dangerous foot, a foot high, is a fucking red card offence if it's up at head height. Or at least it's a booking. If the ref deems it not to be, there's something that you've missed. You have to have some ability to either define what VAR is meant to do or what it's not meant to do. And in the absence of that, here we are yakking on about fucking...
And in VAR Lite, because I would forget this. And of all the things that the Scottish football have put in play for this version of VAR Lite, they've not included goal line technology. Of all the things that is the most important thing in football, is a goal or not a goal? You think... It's been out for, 15 years? To not include goal line technology, it defies belief.
Right, so obviously you forget the last time we trialled goal line technology by putting a linesman on the line.
An SFA linesman.
Remember, we tried that before, and we all know what happened.
We have Hawkeye in Ireland, which is a technology, ironically.
Is that a weapon of some sort?
Good morning.
It's also ironically.
Is that a missile?
Hawkeye.
Okay. Now in the 90s. It's also ironically fucking sponsored by Spexia. There was a huge amount. Obviously, we can score points and the ball can travel at quite significant heights, and it's difficult for an amateur umpire, some of these guys are fucking in their 90s, to see what's going over the bar, even at county level. Last year, huge controversy. They actually disabled it for the second semi-final or the replay of the semi-final, because it got it wrong. It got it so badly wrong. The technology got it wrong. And they made some excuse that the technology wasn't calibrated correctly, but they shut it down. They basically gave it a red card and sent it off for a game. So the technology was disproven by TV, which had already been disproven by 60,000 people in the stadium who'd seen it was a fucking clear and obvious point and it wasn't wide. So you're into this realm of, if you trust the technology that much, and I heard it also mentioned as well, Andy Walker mentioned in the Hearts match also had a touch and go offside. I can't remember which one. And they asked why they didn't put the lines up on that. I'm pretty sure it was the Hearts match.
Yeah.
He said that they didn't have enough time. What? Hold on, you didn't have enough time? So, but quote unquote, they didn't have enough time to do the lines, but trust me, it was offside. Fuck off, Andy. So you have all of this really bizarre strangeness. And I think, to Ralph's point, we're not paranoid enough. We're genuinely not paranoid enough. This stops.
Well, you are our resident business expert, Monty. And I tweeted the other night a joke scenario, but I think there may be major cash possibilities for us here. And that is by creating a site called Refipedia. And it could be the go-to place for... Because I was imagining the conversation. If it's taking that long for them to have a conversation about that... And I pictured the conversation being, so, what do you think? I'm no sure. What do you think? We're no sure. What's the laws of the game say? I'm not sure. Can you look up Refipedia for me quickly? I've only got 2 bars on my phone here. I can't do it. I'm in the middle of Celtic Park. But I know it today. This day, whatever we never done last week. That's how consistent they've been. They've just been changing their decisions. And yeah. if you imagine the pressure on whatever referee gets the game at New Year, mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Do you get that penalty? Do you want to be that ref who makes a decision? And somebody highlighted on various calls or various shows this week, there's not been one referee stuck to their decision yet. They've always went with the VAR decision. England, every now and again, you see the ref going, no, I'm happy with my decision. I'm just going to play on. And they're asking, who will be the first Scottish referee to actually have the balls to say, no, if we're not sure, I'm sticking to what I said at the start, rather than going, right, that's fine. If you see it on the telly with a ruler up against the telly and a felt tip pen, that'll do for me.
I'll give you the script. John Beaton will referee Ibrox. He'll give us a penalty. And then Bobby Madden, who'll be up for the weekend, is going to call him back and say, here, no fucking chance. The rule number 1690. They'll play the orange card and he'll overturn his own decision on the pitch. It'll be beaten. I'll put money on it being beaten.
Yeah, it's madness. It's a classic, but we just matter. Try to do right, we even make it even worse. You know what I mean? Like, I always love to listen to, like, the Scottish football podcast or the phone in the day after they get beaten on that. So I'm like, oh, let's listen to this. And it was like, Hugh Evans was getting a lot of slagging because of the Dundee United game, because of the late goals, because he obviously was on the attack against Celtic for missing chances and stuff. So I thought, I'll listen to it the next day. So I'm listening to it, and Dundee United have scored. Oh, here we go, 2 minutes to go. And then I'm listening to it, and then they go, okay, let's go to, let's say, Pataudry or whatever it was. Right? Let's go to Dunfermline. Okay, tell us the match report. Let's go to Partick Thistle. And they basically went around the grounds. Celtic were still playing because Celtic had been so delayed by VAR. It's like when Celtic never finished till like 10 minutes after the rest of the games had all finished. And I thought I actually like skipped a bit on the put. So I'm getting back and forth. I'm like pressing the back 30 seconds button on the podcast thinking, did I skip that by accident there? How did that work?
Yep.
Because he'd added on so much time. I think it was 5 minutes. 5 minutes in the first half, Hector.
Yep. Five.
I mean, that's not even an injury. That's just piss poor with VAR decisions. So that was it. So let's think positive. A lot of good results and a lot of goals. The goals are flowing in from all areas of the pitch. Although we could be doing a few more, I'd say, maybe from your O'Reilly's and Tatties. I'm not complaining. I'm just saying it would be nice to share a few goals around about the midfield. We've not really seen much of the midfield, really, but the players like Greg Taylor are making up for that, so that was fine. So that then brings us to Viva España, Hector. So you and I can get comfy now and start to get ready to regale our tales of that wonderful trip. But let's go over to Ralph Malve. Ralph, what did you go up to last week? Were you up to anything nice before Hector and I start telling our stories?
No, nothing at all. Because it was a dead rubber game, I wasn't that bothered. I just didn't want us to get embarrassed, to be honest. I was kind of a wee bit jealous looking at the photographs you were sending. And
big bit jealous.
And you've got your new friends now that...
We'll come to that. Just in case, folks, just in case you don't follow us on Twitter or Mastodon, whatever actually we're posting these days, because the world of Etims social media is forever constantly changing these days. But on Etims Twitter feed, Hector, mostly Hector, who had a fabulous time, but we'll come to that in a second. He was posting lots of pics. And I was posting a few from our trip, but we came from various different directions, let's say. But we'll come to that. Let's go up to Monty Seaburn. Monty, were you away on a scouting trip again? You were hoping to make it, but sadly had to call off.
Yeah, I had my travel plans changed, so I ended up down on the Iberian Peninsula at a different date range than I was hoping. So I would have loved to have been there for the trip, but I was in the same kind of headspace as Ralph. It's a kind of dead rubber. It's
going to be the Fucknum headspace. That's
Leipzig was a great trip. I think I mentioned that when it was over, and I really would have loved to do Madrid, but I'm convinced we're going to draw them next year anyway. I think we're going to get them again. But
Atletico would be that would be nice. A lot of people did. A lot of people, Hector and I were discussing this over a quota as a condensation, but as a drop of condensation fell down the side of the very cool beer and the 26 degree Madrid heat. Hector and I were discussing how a lot of people had did the Atletico Madrid tour because the Real Madrid tour was so fully booked. So a lot of people who turned up to go to the Real Madrid tour couldn't get on it because it was all booked up. So they were actually just jumping the subway and getting into Atletico's ground. So let's come to yourself, Hector. You left on the morning, or was it the Monday or the Tuesday?
Tuesday morning. I think I was maybe a couple of hours before you. Is that right? Yeah. The flight. I went via Malaga. You went Alicante, didn't you?
Yeah.
And so obviously in advance of that, we both knew we were going different ways. So Flight was just stacked full of Celtic fans, right? But there's maybe 80%, but you know there's poor sods who have booked their weekend or the week away in Malaga, right? I shouldn't laugh, right? But there was a guy and his wife just in front of us, but there was this couple about four behind us, surrounded by what looked like a supporters bus of Celtic fans. You can imagine, right? They were drinking everything. And I felt a wee bit sorry for them. And then I thought, oh, fuck it, I'm going to get a swally, didn't we? And we did, and we got off at Malaga. And my youngest, just to be clear, my youngest boy, so he's never been away a European trip. So it was a kind of a bit of a birthday present for him. I'd booked it. So he was hyper. And I was hyper, because I've not been to away games since, I think, Valencia. Was that four years ago, maybe? 3 or 4 years ago. And off the flight, and it's... the train connection straight into Malaga. And it's not even the central one. It's the one with the main train station for going over Spain, i.e. Madrid. But we had 4 hours to kill. So we thought, what would we do? Well, we'll go around the corner at the beach. And it was 29 degrees. Pint, lunch, just fabulous. And then we get the train up, the Renfe train, again, which is 2.5 hours to Madrid, straight to Atocha, heart of Madrid. And then we got to our hotel, I think about 9:30, 10:15, dumped the bags, round the corners, just a wee square. Santa Ana Square was lovely. Had a few beers, some tapas, and that was our Tuesday. And it was a lovely Tuesday. You know, we did a few drinks, peace and quiet, few drinks, sing-song, hotel. So that was a Tuesday. How was your Tuesday, Desi?
Well, my Tuesday was good. Bring me. It started off, as I say, I just missed you in the airport. You'd left. This is me and my daughter arrived. So... get through into having the best drinks, airport drinks, officially the best drinks in the world. So it started off with a wee chuckle to myself as I was waiting. I met a few folk who were also going, just like friends of family. A few of them were going with Harry Hines. A few of them were going with the Harry Hines group. So I'm standing in the queue at the main bar, the Caledonia bar, whatever it's called, in Glasgow Airport, just waiting in the queue to get drinks and something to eat for me and my daughter. And two guys randomly behind me start talking to each other. Usual, go to the game, go to Madrid. Yeah, oh, are you on the 10:30 flight? No, I'm on the 10 o'clock. Where were you? I'm on the 10:30 flight. Oh, are you with Hines? Yeah. So how's that work then? And the one guy says, how's that work? And the other guy goes, well, it's great. Really well organised. We get in the night, have a nice wee night, and then tomorrow I go to the game, and then we're on the 12 o'clock flight right after the game. And the guy went, all right, that's good. So what happens when you go back to the hotel for your luggage? And I hear, this is right behind me. I'm dying not to turn around, but I'm kind of happy. No, but you start smirking, and the guy goes, no. Just take it to the game. And the guy went, can I take your luggage to the game, mate? You're not having any bags in. John Paul Taylor's been telling everybody all week, no bags allowed in stadium, right? And this guy's like, oh, fuck, how am I going to get my bag? And you can see it's like 10 in the morning, shitting himself, and he's got 2 days to go. Oh, again, we had an early kickoff, so I'm sure he was fine. But that was fine. Then we get through into the flight. Everything was perfectly fine. EasyJet going. No, Ryanair getting out, and you always fear the worst, but it turned out it was fine. But same, along the same lines as you, like we had a couple of Spanish people in front of us, so a couple of holidaymakers in front of us, and a couple of Spanish people kind of split. The woman was at the window and the guy was behind us, and they're kind of chatting. So everything's fine. But right across from us, five Celtic diehard boys, you know, like young boys, and it looked like their first trip. The wee guys constantly, right? The sing song constantly. The wee steward keeps coming up, having a wee word. Nae bother, mate, nae bother. Any chance you can bring us another vodka? And the guy's like, I'll bring it to you. The guy never arrived bringing me a drink, mate. But they were brand new. Just kept the sing song going. Becomes off the plane. We had to get a bus for the plane to the terminal. It's inside the bus. And sure enough, the boys end up standing next to us. One of them turns and goes, mate, come on, let's get you a Alicante. Dump the bags and go and find some coke, right? Go and find some gear, right? And my daughter's like, I think the last thing they need is some gear, right? We're laughing, fine. We get to Alicante. We're down to the front of Alicante. Lovely big promenade. It's all been done up. Sun's shining. I think it's O'Hara's Bar, Ivy's Bar, something. You can see Celtic jerseys everywhere. Sitting down, having the first drink, taking a photo, posting on Etims. arrived. Lovely, as I say, the condensation down the side of the glass, sun splitting the skies. Who walks in the corner? Two of the young team. That guy's off my flight. Made a beeline for me. Where is everybody, mate? And I went, I don't know. I'm not in charge of the Celtic fans. And I'm like, can't he? I don't know where they are. Right, so that was fine. But then we find me, so then we've done a wee tour of Alicante. We're meant to go to Austin Celtic, the Celtic Supporters Club in Alicante. We're meant to go there. But I pinged him on Twitter. Are you showing the Rangers game? They were playing Ajax. Showing the Rangers game. He comes back. No, we're not showing it. So my daughter says, there's a pub called Murphy's next to your hotel. Are you about to try that? Aye, all right. And he goes, she pings in. Here's the guy says, we're showing Napoli and Liverpool. And my daughter's like, what about Rangers? And the guy comes back, Guillermo, God bless you, Guillermo. Why do you want to watch Rangers if it's a Celtic bar? And we're like, to see them getting beat, to see the Huns getting beat. And he's like, okay, I will put it on. We walks up, met a bunch of young boys from Coke, Bridge and Airdrie. Starts talking to them. They're just sitting outside again, 20, it says 8 o'clock at night, 20 degrees, beautiful. Again, the condensation. I just want to paint that picture for you, Ralph. It's like you're kind of calling there, the condensation rolling down the side. So it's just us and a bunch of boys at Coke Bridge talking away, blah, blah, blah. It made me think of you, Monty, when we used to stay together. A boy was talking about a carbonara pizza. He was expecting it to be a pizza with carbonara on it, but it turned out this to be a white-based pizza, so he was disappointed, but it reminds me of you. If anyone's ever looking for a good carbonara...
Desi, is this the summary version of your Tuesday?
No, I'll get to the good... This is the good part, because you'll like this eventually. And then we find me... anybody wants a good carbonara recipe, Monty's your man.
I'm your man.
So Alicante, 2 minutes before the Rangers game, suddenly a bunch of Celtic jerseys appear from nowhere, right? Well, all right. And this big guy, Sean, turns out, never met him before in life. Again, right out to me, what's happening? And I'm like that, and my daughter's like, do you know him? I went, never met him before in my life. Starts talking to this big guy, so this one of the brilliant characters. Every time the kind of conversation was dying down, it would just start a sing-song, but it was all songs he'd made up himself. And the best one was, there's only one Prince Harry. Old Prince Harry loves the Charlie and the Hash. His mother died in a big car crash, right? And he would just sing that randomly, right? And there's a couple of dirty lines that I can't say on air, but they were if big Sean Fisco Bride's listening, it was a life and soul. But a bunch of boys from Dundee turned up. Someone like Jim Spence on the Twitter. A bunch of boys from Dundee are here. And find me, he says, oh, they must be for Lockheed, whatever it was, right? And I showed one of the boys from Dundee the Twitter feed, Etims Twitter feed. And the boy looks at him and goes, you eat Etims? And I went, I whine. And we went, my ma follows you. so that's officially in the Celtic ma and the Celtic da and the Celtic granda category. So that was the highlight of the night. My ma follows you. So that was us. So that was my Tuesday. After that was just the usual pizza and grub, and then getting up in the morning and getting the train through to Madrid. And then by that time, Hector, you'd already started going out on the Wednesday.
Well, because we were up.
Tell us all about your Wednesday morning.
So we were up the Tuesday night. So we got up on the Wednesday. Say to Daniel, we'll get some breakfast and then we'll get to Plaza Mayor. So for those who haven't been to Madrid, it's a beautiful big square right in the heart of Madrid. But a lot of the Celtic fans had gone there the Tuesday night earlier on. So I thought, right, this is going to be mobbed, as in stowed later on. So we'll go through and have a wee look. And we must have been there about, I reckon, 11 o'clock in the morning. And there might have been maybe about 1,000 fans there already. But 7 Polish Riot fans. And then I thought, oh, here we go. Right? Anyway, so we walked through the square. And I've been recommended to go to a wee kind of market called San... Is it San... No, San Miguel. What do you call it? Something like San Miguel. I can't remember. Anyway, it's like a wee market, like a merchant square, but smaller. And all it is all tapas, wee tapas bars, or wee wine bars, or wee beer bars. Or it was fabulous. So Daniel, my boy and me, we go in, and we're sitting there having something to eat. And it's just like, it's like kind of nice, kind of high stools with kind of benches sitting there. And we're sitting, and just across from us, as in 3 feet, 4 feet, there's a guy with a blazer on. I thought, all right, blazer.
It was
a mirror,
wasn't it?
It was a mirror. My boy's a smart dressed boy, by the way. And I was talking to an older guy, right? And I thought, all right. And there's three other guys with the back to us, but they kind of turn round. I thought, I reckon that's no. It's Ian Bankier, the soon to be departing chairman, isn't it? So he's there. And I said to my boy, I went, oh, it's a couple of the Celtic board. And just as I said that, another three or four bodies come in. So Tony Hamilton, I've met Tony a few times, nice guy. He does the Celtic Foundation. He's there, but I didn't want to interrupt him. But Brian Wilson, who's a good friend of Monty's, he appears. Right. Brian Wilson, right. And I'll be blunt, right. A guy who I've got no time for, right. He appears. But then the Celtic, is it finance director, Chris something? Come on, Ralph, you're the guy who knows all the boards. Right, anyway, so there's about six or seven of them there. Desmond and his son are there, right? It's no surprise. And the chairman, the chief exec, what's his face? Michael something. He's no there. But the rest are all there. So anyway, I'm sitting, me and Daniel, and then 5 minutes later, one of the guys just goes, excuse me. The board guy goes, yeah, would you mind taking a photo of us? That's where his phone. And there's the board all doing a wee mini huddle, me taking a phone. And I went, not a problem. Then I hand them my phone. Do you mind taking one of me and my son? And they burst out laughing, of course. Then before you know it, Desi, you'd have loved this. They've got their tapas. They went, listen, do you want to share some more tapas? And all that. And it was quite surreal. And I'm always the impression you treat somebody the way they treat you. Fair's fair. The newer Celtic fans, talking away to his season tickets, and pleasant enough. So it was a bit of a surprise. Also,
how were the tea and biscuits?
Well, do you know what? It was the tapas and cookies.
Tapas and fine wine.
And it was marvellous. I've totally sold out now. Back the board, folks, back the board. No, but joking aside, there's a couple of them. And one guy's face I recognise, I don't know his name. He's just having a conversation with me. Talking about the team, talking about Ange and all that. And I said, listen, I said, well, over moments, he goes, I've moaned at you guys a hell of a lot over the years, some of the decisions, right? I goes, but Ange has been brilliant, an absolute breath of fresh air. And I says, if you wouldn't mind, whatever you do to keep him, please keep him, because, you know, how he does things, how he talks, he's been brilliant. And oh, thanks for that. And that was it. They were there for a good half an hour. So it was quite surreal. Sitting in their company, they were doing a lot of the conversation, and as they're leaving, Brian Wilson comes over, a big friendly handshake, and he says, pass on my regards to my pal Monty. I went, I will do, Brian, I'll make sure he knows that I met you here in Madrid. So it was quite surreal. It was a laugh, it was funny. So anyway, Daniel, maybe go for a walk, because we're windswept and interesting, right? We're down to the Palace, because we're royalists now, we're friends of the board, and then we went down to Plaza España around the corner, having a few drinks. I mean, I've got them into the mojitos already at 17. I'm a proper dad, right? So we're having a laugh there. And Desi, as usual, Desi's always late, right? My taxi will be in 5 minutes, fucking half an hour later, still no arrived, right? So Desi and his girl, his daughter, they arrive, and we're sitting, as Desi said, tables and chairs outside, Plaza España, right there, beer, the condensation down the side, and Desi. We sat there for about an hour or so, didn't we?
Oh, it was lovely, wasn't it? Lovely.
And you wouldn't have known Celtic were playing. There was no other Celtic fans kicking about there. But we had an hour there, then we went up back up to that market square again, didn't we?
San Miguel, it's called San Miguel.
San Miguel. And a lot of your family, your nephew and their pals, that turned up. We had a brilliant few hours in there, didn't we? It was fabulous.
Yeah, and also, this to paint the picture for everyone. I'm travelling up in this Monty, you may have seen this in the WhatsApp chat, but I'm travelling up to Alicante in Madrid on that rent-free train. It's lovely to be on a train that goes 300 kilometres an hour and it's totally silent. It's unbelievable compared to what we're used to here. But I'm on a train and I'm suddenly starts getting these updates and out for a walk with Daniel. Oh, that's nice. Eddie's up. No, going for breakfast and then back to the room. And it's like Hector's first day out. It's one of the children's books. Up in the morning, went for breakfast, back to room, now heading out. And it was like, in this lovely market. And then it just started getting surreal. Oh, fuck, I think that's bank here. Brian Wilson just shook my hand.
I feel dirty.
It was very pleasant. I don't know. I feel very confused now. No. So, and they always say, Hector, never meet your heroes. They always do say that, never meet your heroes.
Well, if only Peter Law had been there.
Oh, that would be nice on the cake. That would have been nice on the cake.
So we were in the market for a few hours, and there was loads of Celtic fans, but it was civilised, as in people were bevied. But there was food and wine and there was cocktails and beer and we had a great time. So then what we decided to do is, because there was a 2,000 official fans or 2,500.
So what, before we forget, Hector, sorry, because you had a chat room about the fans, didn't you?
Aye. So just an interesting thing. So I don't know the conversation, and we're talking about the numbers who are coming to see Celtic, or certainly be in Madrid, with or without tickets. And the guy whose name I don't know, for the board, said they were talking to the Shakhtar guys the previous week in Glasgow, who came to Madrid, obviously one of the earlier rounds, and they were asking Celtic board about the numbers. And they said, well, obviously what they do is they've got the official numbers, then they speak to the airports, hotels, blah, 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 to try and get a figure on the possible travelling support so they can deal with the police and yada, yada, yada. And he says to me, yeah, so we were informing the Shakhtar directors, they reckon between 14,000 and 18,000 Celtic fans in Madrid on the day of the match, right? Now, having been there, that was right. You could see that. It was certainly in that figure, Desi, wasn't it?
Oh, yeah, it was everywhere you're looking. And again, as you were alluding to there, so we had a great day. And the strangest thing, because usually when you're having such a great experience, it flies by. In that market, time just seemed to go at a lovely slow pace, didn't it? Like as Hector said, like my nephews and their pals, they'd been there for a few days. They came in to meet us. So ended up, we had quite a good wee company, but very civilised. Just drink out. And we were going to leave at one point, and the usual one person get one drink. All right, let's just get another one. But again, the infrastructure is so good. It was just a lovely walk by the palace gardens to get down to the tube. But at that point, you're suddenly like, you realise you've got a drink in you, and you've also been warned that you're in Madrid. The police are very stern. There'd been that kind of video going about the guys fighting with the police, etc. We'd been told no colours, so like none of us were wearing like overt colours or anything. We were all trying to blend in as much as possible. And then we got onto the tube, and it was literally like, if we'd done underground, we went to Celtic Park every Saturday. That's what it would have looked like, wouldn't it? It was just like half Madrid, half Celtic fans on this tube going to the Bernabeu. I mean, we would like...
With a sing-song, the tube with a sing-song, didn't we?
We seem to be the only people that actually paid any notion to don't wear colours, because everywhere around about the Bernabeu, Celtic fans and Celtic colours.
So we'd got tickets in the home end, and I remember we walked up to the ground, and you were one side, I was right, I was kind of behind the goal. So see, they scored the two penalties. My youngest and me, we were kind of on the lower level, just behind. So when they scored it, we get home and watched it, and you see us there on behind the goal. And it was, but what was interesting, you walked up to get in, and it's electronic tickets on your phone. Pulled it out.
Rewind a wee bit before that, but we of course had to go buy the merchandise stall. We were like kids in the fun part. Wait, can I get that?
Well, we get a Madrid hat, so we get in. Baseball cap. And we walk in security, well, Daniel and me, because you're in the other bit, and pulls out the phone, and honestly, if it were to lie, there wasn't a single cop there, just a security person. He went, oh, in you go, and that was it. Couldn't believe how easy it was, and yet we heard horror stories from the folks in the official away section with police dogs and all sorts. So we walked in, and it's quite surreal, because I've done a stadium tour. When I went to Valencia, we went up to Madrid for a day and a night, and I did the stadium tour. But see, get in, and it's your team, and get in there, and seeing Celtic fans all around the stadium. It actually is one of those great, great moments to eventually go to the Bernabeu and see your team. Yeah, I'd get pumped. It wasn't the biggest surprise, was it? But to be part of that and be there. And I've just got to just share something with you. It was part of I didn't get a chance to talk to you much after the game, Desi, because obviously we're bloody done in between. We caught up, it was like a pint and then it was bed kind of thing. You went one way, we went the other. So we were sitting, and it's all Madrid, older season ticket holders. This is the proper, no, we weren't the full of Celtic fans where me and my youngest were sitting. It was all Madrid fans. Be pockets of Celtic fans running about us, but no many. And it was once, I'd say the late 60s, mid-late 60s, been there for 30, 40 years. And the guy just sitting next to me on the right-hand side, he spoke really good English. But majority of them running about us was very little English. So I struck up a conversation as usual, Desi. You use your 10 Spanish words to demonstrate you're not a complete cock, right? They laugh at it and it broke the ice a wee bit. Anyway, talking away. And the guy was saying, yeah, he was in the final in Paris last year and they beat Liverpool. I went, oh, brilliant. He goes, we're from Glasgow. All right, very good. He goes, yeah, well, Zidane got the volley when we beat Leverkusen 2-1 in the final. I went, well, I was at the game. I got a ticket for that. And he went, yeah, I went, blah, 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 blah. Then his pal, can you speak a word of English? He was talking to him in Spanish. And he goes, 1960, first final, European Cup final, 1960. It was at Hampden, and it was 7-3 for Madrid against Eintracht Frankfurt. Well, my dad was at that game. So I grew up knowing my dad was at that game. It was the first time it dawned on me. My dad was at their first final they won, and their second final in Glasgow, I was at it. So that became a topic of conversation. So they're all going like that. I mean, celebrity. They're all going Spanish, going, oh, dos finales, papi, and señor. What a laugh. And Daniel, he's looking at me going, what's going on here, da? And they're all laughing. And that broke the ice. But what was really interesting, the final thing, just on it, and what was really interesting, I think it's important how others see you and others recognise you and talk about you. No, us blowing smoke up our own arses about, look at the signs of your support, we did this in Seville and that, albeit it was great. But it was chatting away, and he said, normally they play clubs, if it's English clubs or Germans, but the atmosphere can get a bit not like this, just not like this, before, during, after, just not like this. He goes, this is proper. He goes, this is proper fiesta of football. And this was the one they won in 5-1 at this. I mean, this was early in the first half. Was this is football. He goes, you guys, you should be here every year. And when you hear that from people who have been round the block many times, been Real Madrid, the greatest club, let's be honest about it, in the world, apart from Rangers, obviously, right? But you hear it from them, the words from them. For me, that was the game changer. This is the number one club in the world, 13, 14 European Cups, telling you this is unique. And our fans doing that.
And, you know, see, listening to it, I really am pissed off that I didn't go on the trip, but...
And me.
Yeah, I'm sure. Ralph, me and you, fuck it, I could just hang up now. I'm having enough. It's nice when it's put in such terms that it doesn't feel condescending.
Yeah.
And I think there's an identity thing to bring it back to the reality as to why we're playing this type of football and being seen for that. It's the guy who's in charge of all things football and Ange Postecoglou. The fact that we were able to go toe-to-toe and get horsed, but not feel bad about it. And actually, the way that we're going about it is the right way to go about it. And I think you mentioned on the WhatsApp, Hector, maybe yourself and Desi, maybe even Ralph mentioned it too, the dark arts is the next stage for us.
So that was, sorry, I can't just come in on that. And I knew there was one. So that was part of the conversation. It was 2-0 half time. He was saying, he goes, Celtic offence, he goes, attack. He goes, no more defence. And I burst out laughing. No. He goes, coach, one way, attack. He goes, you naive, little bit naive. Yeah. And I goes, but he won't change. So it's 3-0, 4-0, attack. And he's actually going, I think they played a team in the Sunday before they played us, and it was one each. Was it Girona they played? Yeah. And he said, Girona on Sunday, every player behind the ball, every player falling down, kicking it away, wasting time. He goes, Celtic, attack, attack, attack. And he goes, but we have great players, Modric, Kroos, Benzema. He goes, so we should win. He goes, but watching how you play, it was great to watch. And it's easy to say that when you're pumping a team, I get that. But I was kind of proud of how we approached it. Yeah. considering we'll be without some of our best players again. One way of playing, and it's the only way if you want to succeed, is to improve, be better players, more experience, a wee bit more quality, be good. It's the only way we'll ever improve. And it's how we should play football. I'm totally buying into how Ange's doing it. Totally now.
Yep.
Again, like we were sat right in the halfway line on the fourth tier or whatever, but it was fine. Again, pockets of Celtic fans here and everywhere. And the odd colour zone, it was amazing to watch. And the Celtic fans, again, I'm up in the top corner, just up for you, like singing the whole game. So you heard Celtic fans the whole game, and you just had that feeling of, this is a goal. I mean, you missed the penalty, you're like, oh, fuck. But you're just like, this is a goal. And then when Jota gets that goal, I mean, you're a folk who'd have won the Champions League in that stadium. The white, everybody, like, I tried to video it, everybody just jumped up. The Spanish people, like, when I don't know about you, Hector, but the Spanish people were about me, are just staring in disbelief at all the Celtic fans going nuts. And then we start singing, we scored in the Bernabeu. We scored in the Bernabeu. As if you'd won it in the last minute. And that, again, it's like every journey starts with one small set. Like, next time we'll score two. Next time we'll only concede four.
No, I watched the first half back again. I think it was Saturday. If you get the chance, just have a look again. The two penalties we lost, and bear in mind, we expect to get beat here, right? Let's you know, under no illusion about it. The two penalties we lost, just get back and look at it. The first one is a miss hit from Madrid's right winger. I miss it, total miss it. And it's a hand, hits the arm. Second one was the penalty because it hit his leg before it hit his arm, right? But if you watch it, we had some great opportunities. And it's not so much the shots, that we missed. No. O'Reilly, I think, was in a couple of positions. It was a simple pass to Abada, who threw 1-1 with the keeper when it was 1-0. And we played such really good, expansive football.
Yep.
But it was our decision. And I think it's just the pressure. We're just not used to the pressure of playing against a team like that. And the bottle goes a wee bit, maybe overexcited or picked the wrong option. Domestically, simple pass. 9 times out of 10, on a plate. And it was an easy pass, and we didn't do the easy pass a few times. And that, for me, was frustrating. But you watch it back going, that's easy things to fix.
Yeah.
Well, I was going to bring Ralph in on that, Ralph. For that game, we had a female ref, Stephanie Frappart. It's good to see this day and age, the quality. It's good to know that the female refs are as bad as the male refs.
Again, to go back to what Hector, and I was listening more to that as well. We are so close to competing on equal terms with some of these teams. It's the decision making, the pass that we would normally make, that difference between the 30, 40 million pound player and the ones we've got, is that half second, maybe a second, where decisions are made, where muscle memory comes into play, where things are done automatically. That was our first season. It was disappointing. But there's a lot to look forward to from these guys if we can keep them together. And even when you see that he's already buying players in the next window, he's already securing defenders. The guys like Abilgaard and Moy were bought to play in the second half of this season. He's working ahead. He knows what the problems are. He's not going to change the way he plays. He's not going to change their attitude to these games. But he's bringing in players that will offer more at this level. And next season, we're going to be a whole lot different. We'll be a whole lot quicker, a whole lot more confident.
My criticism of him, Ralph, my criticism of Ange and the players, and we've all got to be open and honest about it. And I'd mentioned this after the game against Shakhtar, is we're too nice. And someone took that the wrong way. Oh, you want to play like the I've got it all left off. Do you want to play like the fucking Hunts? No, we're not saying that. We're not saying break legs. What I mean is, there's a simple tug of the shirt to take a caution to stop a team in the counter. Because Mudrick's two goals against us were both from the halfway line when he ran on a pole. That's two simple cautions. McGregor away, and I don't know if it was Juranovic or somebody else at home, that arguably cost us a Europa League spot. That was probably possibly two victories there. I just like to see a little bit of the darker arts, and that's what made dark arts. Easy cautions. Just take them, regroup, get back in position again.
But that comes with experience.
Right, the final highlight, because as Hector alludes to there, after the game we're all a bit knackered, but Hector, you did have a joyous moment outside the ground after the game.
Well, you hopefully you've all seen the videos, right? So we've obviously Celtic fans are back. Just let the players come over to season. The players have got beat 5-1. They don't really want to go and celebrate with the fans, but they've probably looked around and went, fucking hell. And they've applauded them and their heads are kind of bowed down. And it was a lovely moment. And the Madrid fans looking on fucking disbelief, looking at us like that, the Dane. Anyway, so we box out, we're even the exit the ground, we're right outside the stadium. And there's Celtic fans coming down the stairwells, and it's an open stairwell, so you can actually, you know, there's no outside cover coming down for the fourth tier, third tier. And suddenly, the new, to the tune of Bella Chow, starts like that. And you're going, fuck. And before you know it, a minute, 2 minutes, 10 minutes non-stop. So people coming down the stairwell, coming outside, the ones outside are no moving. And everybody, and it's going on. And you see the Madrid fans, because they're all walking past this with their phones out. And then they stop. They stop. And they're smiling. And then this is the beauty of it. A lot of Madrid fans are joining in. They're bouncing about with their flags, singing. They obviously don't know the English words, but they know the tune to Bella Chow.
Yeah.
And it was one of those, I'd have to say right up there for me, moments as a Celtic fan. Where it was unique. It was just a wonderful, wonderful moment, you know, that remain with us forever. And it was interesting. There was a guy who does he's got a YouTube Madrid fan. He came to Glasgow. Don't you? These guys have seen it. He came to Glasgow. Did a really good thing, and he was blown away by the stadium and the noise. And he's there after the game where we were, about 20, 30 metres away from us, and he's doing all that, and he's put it on YouTube. And it's all Madrid fans going, fucking hell. I mean, fucking unbelievable. Your team's just been pumped 5-1 and these people are singing Celtic songs non-stop. It was just a beautiful moment. Beautiful moment.
We might manage to get on the soundtrack of the next Money Heist. Because obviously that was the main song in Money Heist. So that would be interesting. Sorry, Ralph.
Yeah, Ralph, is your audio all right? Because you're coming in and out. Sorry.
I've moved it further. I think I put my finger over the microphone. What you were saying there about being too nice on the pitch, I still think we should be a wee bit nastier, or certainly a little bit less welcoming to teams when they come to Celtic Park. Yeah, I've kept on about it, you know, turning the hot water off in the showers, just making them wait in the car park a wee bit longer. Just those little things that put them off the idea of, oh, I need to play at Celtic Park one day. We don't want them to enjoy themselves. We don't want them to go away and tell everybody what a great night they've had. We want unwelcome guests, and we want rid of them as soon as we can after making it as uncomfortable as we can. So the dark art shouldn't be confined to the pitch.
Yeah, Ralph, you've been beating this drum for quite a while now, and it's starting to show us got a wee bit of credence, given the fact that we keep losing at home. But that kind of brings us on. So we eventually all got home from Madrid, and it was a wonderful trip. I wish we'd all managed to be there. Sadly, I'm sure we never. But Ralph, we get back, and it was the AGM. See, this made me think of, I'm just watching the AGM. I don't really pay much attention. Obviously, Hector was sitting with the rest of the board at the AGM, having, what was it, empanadas you brought back with you, and macaroon? San Miguel Market with your tapas deluxe. But the board, the AGM, but somebody, I've seen somebody posted on the board to one of the questions complaining about those young boys singing IRA songs, and one of the replies to that was, I bet you you're one of the fuckers that applaud the opposition off the park. And it made me think of you, Ralph, with the whole member, like, let's stop being so nice and giving the pipers welcome to the bus. Well, that nonsense.
Did you not also see in those replies somebody was complaining about the guy in the Green Brigade with the drum?
Don't bang it so loud.
About 2 years ago when I was sitting above them, I used to hate the noise of that bloody drum. There was me trying to get a wee bit of sleep.
It was you, wasn't it? It was you that made that complaint.
A wee bit of sleep. That was the old Celtic you were watching, you can get a nap.
It was awful. I really put my mouth on. I moved to the other end of the ground since then.
So that could be the new Etims t-shirt slogan: we never nap, never stop. You know what I mean? Right, so I'm wary that poor Monty and Ralph had me much to contribute in the last half an hour. And apologies.
Serves them fucking right, Desi. Right, so
I was in touch, just
Monty, you'll have to wipe your glasses because I went all misty. I can see you've been crying into them that much.
I have.
You're so upset because you're the international jet setter of us all these days.
Just when you mention it, I just went on because I hadn't been on Twitter and donkeys. I've just been too busy. And it was just a wee shout out to Eddie Rin and the lads from the Plowboy CSC in Philadelphia. They're having their 10th anniversary fela from the 9th to the 12th of February. And if any of you are stateside, that's a proper session down in the Plowing Stars. George McCluskey's going to be over as their special guest. And Neil might make a special appearance if we can figure where he is on the planet at that stage. But a whole squad of those boys went over. And, you know, when you were saying about as a spectacle and as a venue and as a place to be, when Hector was talking about just that special feeling coming out of the ground, you've been pumped, but it doesn't matter. It's European Championship or European Champions. And then for that whole Bella Chow thing to start, it's fucking magical. Something really, really magical about it. And as challenging as it is, like I always say this, jealous of you guys. You live in Glasgow or close enough to it, you can get to the games. We have to pick and choose, you know, but that's life. You imagine for people taking that type of trip across the Atlantic to go to a showpiece like that, to do it as a dead rubber. And I know they were gouged for their tickets. They paid hundreds for their tickets. But, you know, that type of dedication to a trip like that kind of, it kind of rings a wee bell for you. I am genuinely fucking raging. I didn't get, but hopefully I'll get over for the failure in February, which will be good.
Well, again, it won't be an hour 42 years before we get Madrid again, so you'll be fine for that. You can start saving.
We're going to get them next year. We're going to fight them next year.
Right. So we're going from Bernabeu, and I've got Bernabeu to Bernabeu to Bernabeu. No fucking way was that a penalty, Ralph. Again, and we've already touched on that, so we'll no bother about the referees and competence or whatever in VAR. But the we never stop thing, late goals, winning a game, is it this the Celtic way now, Ralph? Is that this? Are we even surprised? And do we think maybe the opposition expect it now?
I think it's back to the system that's been drilled into them now for nearly 2 years. 18 months he's been in charge, close to that now.
Yep.
And the thing, playing for 90 minutes, if you're tired, we'll take you off. We're allowed 5 substitutes so we can keep things fresh. And it just keeps going. Other teams might think, Dundee United, I think, certainly thought, oh, that's 2 each. That's a result.
Yep.
But listen to it in Scotland. And the comment, I can't even mind who it was, wasn't it Liam McLeod? It was somebody else, I think. And he said, well, there's 3 minutes left. We know what's going to happen now. Celtic in the attack, and don't be surprised if they score again. And it sounds like the inevitable happened because it's happening so often.
But see, just obviously we're lucky enough we're at the game again. Daniel and me dying, we're at the game. They had a good away support, which was really good. United. So when they equalised 86, 87 minutes, you can imagine they're all gone mental. Whoa, because we pumped them 9-0 at Tannadice earlier this season. So suddenly they're 2 each. 87 minutes, right? But just but you said there, Ralph, it's interesting. We're thinking 3 minutes to go. There's 3 minutes to go, and there's probably another 3 minutes injury time here. Now we're not saying it out loud, but I'm thinking to myself, listen, we're not resigned to a 2 week straw. By the way, you're actually still thinking ahead here. I think we're going to go and win this, and then lo and behold, when Kyogo, the Flincon Baralston scores, you can imagine the scenes. Bedlam, right? And we've just stopped celebrating, making it 3-2. And the second sub was brought on, Abada, gets through. And an incredible finish, albeit our friend VAR was called in for a possible offside, but even in real time, I'm going, might have never touched that. I mean, he never touched it. We could see he never touched it. I thought, why is this taking 3 minutes anyway? Goal. But that was the thing about never stop. That's not a new phenomenon for Celtic. We were younger. Celtic, Billy McNeil's teams always seemed to score a lot of late goals. Jock Stein's team did.
Did it repeatedly.
But I think it's the consistency of Angie's teams doing it now. St Johnstone equalised 92 minutes and we scored 94 minutes, Giakoumakis. Yeah. Tynecastle were behind a couple of times, we kept going. There's just this consistency to it.
So what are we saying here, that Andy's team consistently let in late goals? Is that what we're saying here? Are we criticising that Celtic defence at this point? Is that what we're coming down on this?
I think the second goal they got was one of the things. It was a good cross, wasn't it? And I think Watt was going to header it, didn't it? It was one of the 10 minutes
it was coming.
I thought Watt was going to header it, so the keeper was actually left a difficult position, because if he doesn't stand his position and he dives to his left, then lo and behold, it's a glance into an empty net, isn't it? So it was a hard one. But you're right. But the breakup of the game, it destroyed the flow several times. But anyway, but we won again. And it put the pressure on you-know-who come Sunday, didn't it, Desi?
Yeah, but before we get to that, Monty, let's not forget that the third goal basically clinched the game. That third goal came straight out of the Gavin Strachan laptop guide to set pieces.
He's in charge of set pieces now.
So we're going to give praise where it's due. That's been a few this season.
And amplified praise at that, given that most of the team are about 5'4". And Kyogo's, what, 5'7"? And he gets himself free in the box and glances a header in.
And just get the bad news about the whole no going to the World Cup. So that was, he could quite easily chucked it.
I'd like us, actually, just, it's an interesting one. I'd like us to, well, how can you do it with small players? In Barcelona, we're never good at corners. You know, it's just not going to be our forte, but we get so much, we dominate the ball so much domestically. We get so much possession in the box and we carry so much threat to get corners that it's a shame that we don't really have an engine off
watch
the back.
Watch that goal again. See that Kyogo's third goal? There's a camera behind the goal angle of it. Mm. And watch Kyogo's movement to the goal. He starts at the edge of the box and he kind of shuffles kind of left to right, then sprints diagonally to the 6-yard line just in time for Ralston, the ball coming for Ralston. So to actually mark him would be almost impossible. If the ball's in that area, it was almost impossible. The run was incredible. Incredible run.
That was an actual set piece, an orchestrated set piece, as if it was a fluke or a lucky touch.
But it's up there with our Champions League conversion stat, you know. We had 3 goals and 67 chances. How many goals from corners, you know?
But this reminded me two things which was interesting. Sort of like, to be fair to him, Gordon Diallo in the Super Scoreboard the night was talking about, he's basically saying, Kent hasn't turned up, he's like, and I don't care what the stats are saying, like they try to claim Kent was is statistically the best winger in the league. But he says, I don't care what the stats say, if Ryan Kent was playing like that for Celtic, he would be immediately replaced and he wouldn't get back in the team. Because Celtic have that competition and it spurs you on to be the best you can, because you know you will get dropped. If there's a better guy waiting to come in than you're doing at the moment, you'll be replaced. Ange will replace you. Whereas Kent's an automatic first team pick for some unknown reason, because they've not got anybody better. I mean, so it's quite interesting the fact that even though he's playing mediocre and shit, let's be honest, still they can't replace him, whereas we've got that competition for places. Yeah. I've seen Forrest come in and score a hat-trick then get dropped the next game, these sort of things. Maeda, Kyogo, Giakoumakis, you know what I mean? So,
yeah.
It's a good problem we have. So the next game's Monty, Motherwell and Ross County, and then it's the World Cup of all things.
Are you going
for tomorrow?
What's that, Ralph?
The Australian Super Cup or the Sydney Super Cup or whatever it's called.
Oh, I've got that. Aye, Sydney, Everton. Aye, does anybody really care? I noticed they've changed the time of the Everton game. I don't know if that's trying to attract more people or this for TV. Reminds me of a TV deal. I never paid much attention.
I mean, 6 points this week, given how the table looks after all the football we've played. 6 points this week before the break would be just really, really nice. And, you know, the nearest challenger, they're in a little bit of disarray at the minute. They don't have the squad depth that we have. Their manager's obviously a little bit on the ropes, and he comes across as a decent, straight-talking guy. But You know, St Mirren was a big shock for us. I don't think them getting beat by St Johnson was the shock that it was made out to be, but they did dominate the game. They really should have been 3 or 4.
No, it was almost a trophy for corners, remember.
corners, but Monty, they never created many chances.
They cracked the bar twice. Hector's
ahead of their corner, which was the shot the second half, and they were 2-0 down at the time,
weren't they? 2-0 down at the time. So it was one of those games that if you were watching it as one of them, well, firstly, you'd be an ugly bastard. Secondly, you'd be just knowing that you're not going to win the game. You just know it. You know.
Even their goal was a rubbish goal, wasn't it? It was lucky it went through two or three players and the keeper.
But when you're in that zone, like where we've gone and, yeah, we went down, but we died with our boots on, arguably, in the Champions League. They've got fucking annihilated 6 times and not even close. Napoli, ironically, Napoli at home for them. And I watch their games because I'm a fucking masochist and I don't mind watching them to see where's their strengths. They weren't that bad against Napoli at home, but Napoli just turned on the gears. Outside of that, they got fucking horsed. And that's really, really difficult mentally. When you're a tight squad, two of your main men are obviously on the way out the door come January. They're going to be pre-contracts are gone. They have no money for replacements. They've got a guy who, you know, Dutch managers by repute, they're just straight. If they don't think you're good, they're just telling you you're shit and that's it. And fuck you. So there's no big hugs or any of that. Squad cohesion over there has got to be a problem, and there's no new blood coming in. So, you know, we really can push on here, but nothing's ever done that's done. I would just love us 6 points, Desi, over the next 2 games. Let whatever will be across the city be, but it would be nice to have maybe a 9-pointer, a 10-pointer going in the World Cup. It would be lovely.
Yeah, and Ralph, you're
breaking up a wee bit there.
Was I repeating? I was saying we've got all our business done for the Daniel Window, apparently.
Obviously, the Japanese boy Yuki. There'll be others. I have a feeling we're going to get a right back because of some rumblings that have been mentioned.
Sorry, can I get what? Say that again.
You going to get a what?
I have a feeling we're going to be getting a new right back because of some rumblings that have been.
Branovic?
Is it
Fireball rather than Fireball?
He's not.
He might have a good World Cup. He might be one of the players that have a good World Cup, and you get to add a few million onto his fee. That would be a nice touch if it comes
best for him. As for the rest of it, we've got the big Danish guy to come in and strengthen the midfield. Reading today that McCarthy's got a hamstring injury, so he's going to be pretty much out of it again. We're going to get injuries. We're going to get players dropping out of favour. We're going to get players dropping out of form. But we're in a situation with maybe 25 guys that can start again. So,
and Ange was,
which Ange is was, a whole change in culture.
Sorry, Ralph. I was just saying, the AGM last week, Ange did an interview after the AGM. He was very, very candid. And he basically said to Celtic fans, I know I need to reinvest to get better.
Yes.
So some of your heroes in effect right now.
So, yeah.
I'm going to have to move some of your heroes on, is what we're saying in January. So I don't Juranovic is no surprise because he was getting hooked about before the deadline. But that's fine. But I actually think the fact Ange said that makes me think Jota is going to go in January for big money. Yeah. And Ange is going to take that money and go bang. Because he's lined up the players for January already, apparently.
Sorry, Jota or Giacomagus. Apparently, a big bustling centre half is all the rage in the Premier League now. Everybody wants a Haaland or a Haaland light. And apparently, there was serious interest in Giacomagus before the window closed. And it wasn't from the bottom tier of the Premier League either. Apparently, it was mid tier Premier League teams. So you could see maybe a curveball, but I would agree with you. Our most saleable, marketable asset is arguably Jota for his quality and his effectiveness. But then Giacomagus's goal scoring record when he starts is fucking second to none.
But the beauty of Ange, the beauty of how Ange does things, is that if they go, you hate to lose guys who contribute and they're good players. But you have every confidence that the ones he brings in, his words, a better version of these players.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
We could probably also do with an R striker, let alone sell a striker. This is a backup into those wet, cold, wintry months coming ahead. You know what I mean? Let's be honest.
You love them, don't you?
This needs a shitty night up in Ross County or a bad
We've got a 5 week break, so it's.
Yeah, I don't mean, but I'm just saying, like, looking ahead. And again, you want to bed them in, as Ralph was mentioning there, like, again, like, we did well getting Hatate and all that in straight away. Remember, hit the ground running.
Hulk Maneno less.
That's what I'm saying, mate. Hit the ground running, and then just, we literally, that was it. The game was, the league was done at that point, so you'd want to continue. And again, let's be wary. And can he hit the bullseye every time, every signing? Can he hit the ground running? So we just have to try and hope we don't have too many.
Oh, negative. Here he goes. Negative, negative.
Oh, no, I'm just saying, it would be nice. I accept the market forces are a player will want to leave.
Finish the podcast the high. Mr. Negative. Here he
goes. Listen, just because you become a bored Madrid-loving fascist these days.
That's harsh.
Look at you with your white hanky there, waving a white hanky in the podcast.
Poster of Franco up behind him.
What I'm saying is, it'd be nice to, if we lose one this window, fine. If we lose two, that'd be a shame. But if we lose one and then we invest the money and bed somebody in for the summer, that'd be great. And then lose somebody.
I think that's what he's basically said, Desi.
I've said that. Probably like that whole kind of darlings. I think he's got it, and Monty kind of alluded to it with the whole Van Bronckhorst might be the same mentality. You know, if you're out the picture, whereas Ange is more of a, I'm sorry, but we need to kick on, and you're no part of the kicking on plan, or you're a paving stone to get to the next, a stepping stone to get to the next step. Sorry, I need to get a new right back, or I need to get a new centre mid, that kind of thing. I mean, like these ideas. So it will be interesting. I mean, to see where the next market will be. You talked a lot about the Iranian market and that before, remember? So I wonder if we go back to that, the Turkish market, there's a lot of business there. That'd be interesting.
Problem with Turkey is the wages. They're on huge wages over there, apparently, because it's all tax-free. Watch O'Reilly as well. Apparently, that Newcastle interest was serious. But again, in pure business terms, and this goes back to his relationship with Nicholson and his relationship with Lowell's son, and how this dynamic works.
Ask Hector, he'll tell you.
Well, so if you can,
if like you can phone Hector, this dialing up.
Yeah, hi.
Give Wilsey a call there.
Yeah.
Did you see that call blocked?
You don't need to get a photograph of the board. One of them gave you his phone. How you never sprinted out of that room and checked all the WhatsApp messages.
And
I did a Bluetooth all the numbers off it.
Picked them up.
It was the fact they read the words "and out" on the board's phone, Ralph. That was the worry.
Aye, I know.
So when Bankia refers to him as our esteemed manager, we know we're fucked again. Back to the slowly.
Right. So this to wrap up. We'll wrap up with a joke. Ralph, Jason Cummings is going to the World Cup with Australia, and Tom Nodgick isn't. And what strange world of football does that sort of thing actually happen? What the hell happened there? This feels so weird that Tom Nodgick ended up going to West Brom, the manager leaves a week later, and he's just left in the football wilderness. What a waste.
This year, it's a horrible place. Football ground jumps up out of some terraced houses and a couple of factories. Why? Imagine getting up in the morning and going to work there. Oh, no.
That was a man from Stoke there talking, everyone. That was Ralph Mal from Stoke.
For someone who was in Stoke.
It's like fucking talking up the virtues of gonorrhea when you've a dose of syphilis. For fuck's sake.
Next week on the Etims travelogue, Monty takes us a trip round Lurgan. What a shithole. It's a lovely place.
You've done the Lurgan pub crawl. Come
on. It's a lovely place, Lurgan. That's it, Ralph. Come on, try and be a bit nice on that. I mean, you've just listened to Hector talk to Madrid like it's his second home now. He's moving there next year.
And by the way, folks, hey, it's not even as expensive as likes a Rome and all that. It's very, very, very fair prices, Desi, wasn't it?
When you get bored of expenses, then you're no caring about it. Now, let's be honest. It's the Celtic fans that are paying your tapas.
maybe Hector will sell one of his Hebridean smaller islands, you know, in France.
Exactly. The Irish feed industry is doing very well in this.
Well, you know who owns that, don't you?
Yes, we do, Mr. Rosenblatt.
Good personal friend of mine.
Indeed. Hoping to see him at the wedding too in March.
Hector, Etims, Rod Stewart. Who'd have thought it?
I know.
Who's the chances? So that was us. So it's been a very good, positive time since our last chat. Lots of victories, lots of goals, and even a goal in the Bernabeu, and a wonderful trip for some of us to Madrid. Hopefully, as Monty said there, hopefully two wins this week and over the next couple of days, and then we can relax to our World Cup. So before we finish, Hector, predictions, World Cup, what do you think?
Don't care.
Oh, come on.
No, genuinely, I've not given the World Cup a second thought, if I'm honest, honestly, because we've been playing back to back to back. And normally it's in the summer, the league's finished by about 3 weeks, 4 weeks. I have not given it a second thought. Who do you want to win it? Argentina, no, Messi, Argentina, possibly.
You see, to be fair, that's a very fair point. I noticed Daniel Story, good friend of the site, I noticed Daniel Story mentioned today that they're playing it in Qatar in the winter. But it's 38 degrees the day in Qatar. Even in the winter, it's 38 degrees. So, I mean, imagine the pace this ball's going to be going at for the World Cup. And I've seen a lot of people in Football 365 saying, you can't slide Qatar and then have poppy celebrations, Monty. The whole kind of sports washing, which I thought was interesting. You know what I mean?
Yeah, but do you know, the more I tune out of all of this bullshit, the easier and more happier my life becomes. Because ultimately,
the man who sat and gritted his eyes out the night at Tales of Madrid.
Oh, you know, I'd see on the World Cup thing, I would love my adopted country, Portugal, to win it. I think they have a real good chance. Outside of that, Brazil. I think Brazil have got such a forward line and their back line is solid.
Our goalkeeping line could play centre forward.
They're just though. I think those two teams are different gravy. I would love Argentina to do it purely for Messi, but they're not. They're shite. Let's be honest. Argentina are shite. They scraped through.
I'm going to put 30 quid in Argentina on it now.
You're
here first, folks. Monty says 1-0. For the man who said Emilio Baldi was a world class striker.
There's a player in there.
There's a player in there somewhere. You heard it here first. I know Dani Alves is in the Brazil squad. 39. I mean, right. It shows you. You still got him doing. So, Ralph, the Etims member who lives in England, are you looking forward to a World Cup?
I always like them to have a good run and get beaten penalties because it's nice. Odd.
Harry Maguire's in the squad. There's no chance.
Get to the final. Let them get as high as they can before they crash. But this time round, I think anybody, any player, any manager, anybody that goes to that World Cup over there, given the place it is, should be fully ashamed of themselves.
Well, that's interesting.
It'll be
interesting to see. Does anybody even know what time the games are on? Have we seen a schedule
yet? They're not bad, actually. If you want to take a day off, you could watch a game at 10 in the morning, 3 in the afternoon, 5 at night, and 10 at night. They're really fucking spread, now maybe I'm exaggerating that. There is a schedule out there, Desi, that'll show you the various kickoff times, and they are like sort of mid-afternoon, sort of lunchtime, mid-afternoon, I think, and early evening is by and large it. You're talking about, what, 5 hours ahead anyway, isn't it?
At least I would imagine.
I think Doha is 5 hours, but while I agree with everything that Ralph just said on the nature of you know, Qatar's sort of fucking persona, I mean, I think everything needs to look inward before it starts throwing stones outward. You know, Britain's no fucking paragon of anything. So anyway, enough.
It's only 3 hours ahead.
Three?
Yeah, Greenwich Mean Time.
Totally, GMT. Right, yeah, so 5 o'clock. Your evening kickoffs will be 5 o'clock then, most likely.
Well, again, but that is interesting. That's kind of, and it does reflect a lot of stuff I've saw it on Football 365. Hector's kind of remarks there. So it'll be interesting. Again, it'll be interesting also try to see the media try to get people to buy into it. No, because obviously they've paid heavily, etc. So they're going to have to.
Well, listen, once it starts, there's no domestic football. We'll all start watching it. Yeah. That'll be no different. But up till now, genuinely haven't given it. Because Celtic's had so many games, I've not given it.
Haven't had time.
Second thought, yeah.
I see Blatter, just on the politicking of it before we wrap it out. Blatter came out today and bizarrely said it was a mistake to award it to Qatar. That's the same Sepp Blatter, if I'm not mistaken, who's up on all sorts of criminal charges for all sorts of financial fraud, right?
Yeah. Let's not start, because then I'll have to tell you about the time I met Michel Platini when I was in Seville, but that's another story for another time. I've still got the memento in the loft somewhere. Right, so we'll wrap up there. So it's been a very good experience. Hopefully it will probably come out post-World Cup. When's the next game? November, December?
December the 20th, yeah, I think, well, against Aberdeen.
Before Christmas, isn't it?
Aberdeen here getting beat 2-0 at the minute, who missed a penalty and I think got a second VAR penalty. So that's another two VAR awards to Aberdeen at the minute.
Oh, interesting. Okay, right, so we'll just wrap up there. So it's just left for me, Desmond, to say thank you very much to Ralph Mal. Thank you, Ralph.
Cheers. Thanks.
Monty C. Burns. Thank you, Monty.
Thanks, Desi. Thanks, Lex.
And buenas noches to mis amigos. Hector Bandido. Adios,
amigos.
Hector Bandido.
Dos grandes cervezas, por favor.
That's your name. Buenas noches.
A la Madrid.
Okay, folks, as ever, thanks very much for listening. My name is Desi Mon. Good night.